I have made this channel for the curveballer that I thought might wake up, because I was able to help them wake up from the deception of 9/11, that our government perpetrated it, that there was no so-called hijackers with box cutters. That's a figment of the imagination that they want us to buy into, so they have an excuse to foment war around the world for these fake terrorists. I was able to, after several interventions and videos, to get the globe-tard curveballer to wake up from the deception of 9/11, to where it was admitted, yeah, it was definitely not hijackers, it was the government. I mean, certain people I couldn't wake up. I mean, they wanted to believe the lie. I mean, even when you point out to them, why would the government declare national security on firefighters' audio? Well, what's the national security in that? Just like they wanted to suppress the Zapruder film. They cut segments of it out. I mean, they've still got segments of the evidence for Kennedy assassination hidden from the public. They've not released certain documents. It's ridiculous. Only someone that has something to hide does things like that. It's obvious. People don't want to see the obvious nature. It's like this right here. See, the flat earther just postponed his plan to launch himself into a homemade rocket Saturday. Look, many flat earthers believe the earth is a disc despite overwhelming scientific and photographic evidence that it is spherical. There is no overwhelming scientific evidence. There is none. Even Einstein said you can't prove it's a ball. But all I've got is this, NASA. And then the curveballer want to say, well, how could all the governments of the world are lying? Yeah, to steal tax money. Exactly. Just like all the governments, all the major governments, went into the war of terrorism. It's the same thing. Don't you understand, curveball? The same arguments people want to have for 9/11. That the whole government would be involved in a lie. Yeah, maybe not the entire government, but certain key people and other people don't care. They just want to go along with it. You don't want to stand apart. It's just like when they first started faking this ball earth bullshit. They prop up so-called smart people like Einstein, and then all the church laid down and said, okay, well, it must be a ball, even though your Bible says it's flat. It's a flat earth book, and nobody wanted to preach it. That's why it says they won't stand sound doctrine in the end. Photographic evidence comes from NASA. You want to trust your lying ass government? Go ahead. I mean, I thought I was done after movie number 4, where I show you the, what was it, lunar eclipse? It can't be the shadow of the earth. Selenium. Check out the video in the playlist on the Selenium, where the guy's photographing the eclipse up in Norway. I mean, if he pans out, you'll see the sun is over on the left, but the shadow is creeping or disappearing from the right of the moon as the moon's rising. It's daylight, because you've almost got 24 hours of daylight in Norway at this time of the year. So how could it be the earth? I mean, if it was the earth, wouldn't the shadow be coming down from the bottom up? I mean, it's just stupid. People don't want to question what they're told. They just want to believe, just like people believe on 9/11 that had to be terrorists. I mean, you had the guy that was running the Defense Department, McNamara, come out in a movie called Fog of War, you know, right around 9/11, where he said, yeah, the Gulf of Tonkin that started the whole Vietnam War was a lie. It never happened. I mean, but you got to be bombarded with this in your face before you'll finally admit to it. That's why any curveballer that would believe that 9/11 was not what they said it was, that that was an obvious lie by the government, to then turn around and say, well, all the space agencies would be involved. Yeah, They're all involved in the war on terror, which is an obvious lie. I mean, how can you not see the two are the same thing, silly? Wake up. It's just cognitive dissonance. It's like the Bible says, if you believe the earth is flat, you know there's a God. End of story. And you don't want to admit there's a God because you take pleasure in unrighteousness. So any kind of bullshit story they'll give you to make you think there's not a God, yeah, that's what you want to believe. Well, don't fear men that can only kill the body. Fear the Creator that can burn your soul forever without cease, without end. That's who you should fear, not these people that can kill you. We all die. What do you want to fear? Ridicule of men. What do you want to fear? Their weapons. They're going to kill you. They're going to do the, who cares? Let them kill you. You better get right so you go to the right place when it's all over. Don't believe a lie just because it's convenient for you in this short temporal life. I'm sorry, curveball. I'm just a little frustrated with the amount of cognitive dissonance that I go through with the curveballers just not wanting to believe what I put together. They just don't want to entertain that it could be real for anything. Like movie 4 was taken down and stated that it was copyright violation. I talked to the curveballer saying, look, I'd sent this to some big flat earth channels, and obviously one of the ones I sent it to was a shill because they've watched it and immediately had YouTube kick it off and say it's copyright by UMG or some stupid shit. And I tell this to a curveballer, hey, I must be on target because I wanted to take down my movie. That means there's some obvious truth there. They don't want the normal Joe Blow curveballer, blowtard, learning about, because it might make them think, hey, I'm being lied to. I'm not on a ball. I mean, your own senses ain't enough for you people to believe that it's not a ball. So this stuff I put together a movie for, I titled They Lie, We Live. I had to mail it to a curveballer. I wanted to see, he's the reason I made the movie, because they wouldn't go on YouTube. And he's like, well, it must have been the music. You had too much music. You know, I know for educational purpose, they let you use copyright material like 5 minutes of it. Now, mind you, this guy's talking like this. He's never made a YouTube video, so he doesn't know. But if you read the information when you're putting this shit together like I did when I created the fucking channel, you'll find out that as long as you're not trying to advertise, you can use all the copyrighted information, okay? Music, it doesn't matter. And besides that, this curveballer doesn't even probably watch all my content because all that stuff, the music and the clips that were in movie 4, They Lie, We Live, was all stuff from an earlier movie I titled Seeing the Curve. And I think most of it was part 6 and part 9. But all that music's in there, and none of that stuff has been pulled down because I never forwarded to these shill channels to where somebody watched it and said, oh yeah, we don't want them seeing that one. Just copyright it. It's just like this here, curveball. Look at this. You click on that one. That was an obviously good movie. Look at this. Been removed by the user. If you ever see something removed on my channel, like that movie had been taken down, and they said deleted by the user, it's a fucking lie. YouTube is lying to you. I don't take down shit. If I waste my time uploading it, I don't take it down. Now, this is one movie that I've copied and placed. Pasted in there, and some of these stuff that I put in here just really make the hair on the back of my neck stand up. This is real hard-hitting truth that I want the curveballer to see, and this was one of them, but I can't remember what the video was entitled, so it's down, you know, it's not there, which sucks, but what are you gonna do? Now I don't remember what it was entitled. That's why I've been getting in the habit of just downloading all my stuff to a hard drive and saving these movies. I believe this deleted movie was from this guy, Flat Earth Brothers, that I'm going to add in this movie here, snippets of some of these. I'll just leave them up. Because when I make a hard-hitting movie, from other people. I just want to take out snippets of it because I don't really think somebody that doesn't believe there could be a possibility that the Bible's true and that the earth is flat, they want to believe in the lies of men, they're not going to watch these. They're certainly not going to watch 41 of them here. Or what do I got going on here? 46 so far in this month? I mean, they're just not going to entertain that. I mean, I'll get platitudes and be told, yeah, oh yeah, I saw it. That's good stuff. But no. It's always a circular argument with curveballers. You know, when you get onto the real stuff, man, they don't want to talk about that very long. They want to talk about, how do you see the sun in the southern hemisphere? How do you see certain stars down there that you can't see up here? I mean, just silly stuff. It's very simple. If you figure that it's flat and we're a lot bigger than all that shit in the sky is, like the Bible says, the stars will fall to the earth. That means, just like in 1984, like truth in the movies, lies in the news, that little statement there is a fact. Because they let the truth out in the movies. And the lies in the news are, NASA sent up a probe to look at the star that's 10 million light years away, and it's 5 times the diameter of our sun. It's a superstar. And it's going to make a supermassive black hole when it implodes. All this retarded shit. Well, one box is right, one box is wrong. Meaning, the Bible says they're going to fall to the earth, which means the stars that they claim are suns must be smaller than the earth if it's going to hit the earth. But science and the news will plainly tell everybody they're way, you know, 50,000 Earths could fit in one of these suns. I mean, just nonsensical shit. But in the movie 1984, they tell you, hey, the stars are far away or near, depending on how we wish them to be. They tell you stuff in these movies. So I'm pretty sure that one that was deleted was like that. I'm going to try to find it and put it, the snippets that I wanted you to see, in this Part 7 movie. And I'll download them in case, again, it's deleted. But I won't put any music on there, and I certainly won't take the time to notify any of the big channels so that this information gets seen widely. I'll just disperse it to you and leave you to conclude that it's true yourself or do a little investigation. And what I mean investigation is you're going to have an opportunity to investigate this stuff truthfully in 6 years, in 2024, when we have that solar eclipse. I mean, I've had curveballer tell me, sun gazing, you can't look at the sun, it'll hurt your eyes. Well, obviously, curveballer, you've not experienced a lot of pain. Because if you'll just gut through the pain when you look at your eyes and your eyes start to water and you have to close them and squint, well, you won't go blind because there's something called sun gazing. It's a real thing. It really happens. People do it. And they do it primarily for religious practices. See that? Religious practices. Just like the Bible says, all that shit in the sky, the sun, moon, stars, is a, it's a calendar. It's for seasons and all this, but it's also a sign unto you. But it's only a sign if you look at it. Sun gazing, see? People can do it. Now, they want to tell you in the news, a lie, that if you look at the solar eclipse, you'll go blind. See, the eye can still be exposed to harmful levels of ultraviolet radiation. Right, sure. Bullshit. I call bullshit. If it's not even radiation, you know what I'm saying? They lied to you about what the sun is. It's inside the dome firmament, just like the moon and the stars. The only thing above that is God's heaven. Okay? So they lie. Cataracts and all this, they want to make you in fear. How can it be a sign to you if you couldn't look at it because you're going to have a cataract or you're going to go blind? Listen, I looked at the last eclipse. Am I blind? No. Did I have to go get stronger glasses? No. That's why I say in 2024, you can question the lies of so-called the news and men. Like the Bible says, God be true and every man be a liar. Question the bullshit. Look at it yourself. Better yet, just film me looking at it, you puss. Get you a welding helmet or something when you look at it yourself. But take it off so you can see me staring at it the whole time. And then I'll describe what I looked, what I saw. And when I show you a camera footage of it, I'll be like, yeah, that just looks like a dark, you know. But it looks like a ball, like a pupil of an eye if you look at it with your own fucking eye. And it's obviously real smooth. There's no mountains, no craters. That's why they don't want you to look at it. Because you'll realize when you look at it with your own eyes, it ain't the moon. Wake up before you burn up. Honestly, curveballer, I'm not going to make any more movies. I mean, I'm going to take movies made by people, maybe upload them to my channel that I find interesting, but I'm not going to spend any more time making movies to try and wake you up, because just like they do here where they delete movies that I put in there and then it states that I deleted it because I'm the user, so I deleted it, and I don't delete shit. That's frustrating, and that should tell you right there. That should speak volumes to any so-called truth-seeking globe-tard curveballer out there. When you see stuff like this that I know was hard-hitting, being deleted, and more than that, like this movie number 4 that I put up, that I told the curveballer was my best movie, and he told me it was copyrighted when he went to watch it on his computer, but when you log in to my channel as me, it's not copyrighted. I can watch it myself all day long. See, they don't want me to know that they're blocking everybody from seeing it. They're not telling me, see. They know I'd probably get pissed if they took down my movie and said some bullshit like I deleted my own movie. That's too obvious. So they do shit like this where they leave it up and it just doesn't get any views. But I don't know why it's not getting any views, you know? I can click on it and watch it. Looks fine, plays fine.
Do it again.
But if somebody else tries to watch it, hey, it's copyrighted. Let's see, what's so nice about it is I put in these little segments out of TV shows and movies where they show you the truth. They tell you here in this movie, the maps are wrong. Well, if it's a ball, why would the maps be wrong? Why would continents be the wrong size? It's ridiculous because it's not true. But you gotta, just like our former president George Bush declaring national security on firefighters' audio, the FBI confiscating all the videotapes from hotels and gas stations near the Pentagon, paper passport of the lead hijacker, Mohammed Atta, being found on the sidewalk near the buildings, or the BBC newscaster talking about Building 7 being collapsed when it's still up behind her in the background. I mean, these things tells you that it's an obvious setup, lie, bullshit story. And I hope in this last installment here in Movie 7 to prove that this shit here where they block it for copyright to the outside world, but me, the maker of the video, plays fine. There's nothing wrong with it. Or this other video being deleted, or any other video being deleted. Like I decided, eh, that's no good. I want to take that movie out, and then I delete the movie. It's bullshit, okay? This is garbage. These are things that are too much truth they don't want you to see. I mean, that tells you that what they're showing you is a lie. Just like the harnesses seen on the astronauts or actornauts in the so-called ISS. If they're out there, why do they need harnesses to float? All these little anomalies, like bubbles in space. Well, you know they train in pools, so they're faking their video in a pool. That's the only way you can have bubbles. But people, oh, that's not a bubble. Put all this shit together, curveball. It's just like the lies of 9/11. Only this is dealing with space. Now, when I mean, hopefully we live long enough. It's like the frog in the pot. They do all this shit very slowly on a long time scale, so as not to make a connection. Hopefully they'll do this fake alien invasion shit in the near future, so that you'll definitely say, damn it, guy on the flat earth, he must be right. He was saying that's what it's about, faking an alien invasion. Wake up before you burn up. It's all about you. Remember, it's all about them hiding God from you, not wanting you to know your creator. The Bible is a flat earth book. It tells you numerous scriptures. One flat earth guy states there's over 200. I personally know there's over 40 verses referring to the flat earth. Okay? So somebody's lying to someone. Do you really want to bet your ever loving soul that it's the Bible's a lie and man is telling you the true skinny? When have they ever told you the truth about nearly anything that's of an important nature? They lie about all things important. Just as I've shown you, curveballer, that the purveyors of truth on YouTube would like to prevent you from seeing my movie, They Lie, We Live, by stating it's copyrighted stuff and deleting certain movies in my playlist. All of this to downgrade the knowledge that you're given. The same thing was done when they put the Bible together. Just like it states in the book of Revelations, anyone, I think it's chapter 19, somewhere in there, it states anyone that adds to or take away from this book, their name will be taken out of the book of life. What they took out, in my opinion, would be Enoch. Different books like Jasher. These the books that are in there, there certain two or three references are made in the Bible to the book of Enoch, and hopefully in this movie you will see that the two correlate, just like YouTube removing my stuff for shitty reasons, which are bullshit. They've removed Enoch from the Bible so that they could later bring in this lie of, you know, Copernicus and the sun at the center, and we revolving around there. And maybe you'll see it, or listen to the Book of Enoch that I've, you know, provided here on the channel. It's kind of a hard read, so maybe you could listen to it and pay attention to the facts given in it. But I'm wondering if the Wycliffe Bible and all these preceding the King James Version had the Book of Enoch in it, and then when they brought Copernicus in to battle the Bible with learning versus learning, that philosophy, like the 15th century's version of the Hegelian dialectic, where they try to overturn what the Bible says about science, when they brought in this globe Earth and the sun being at the center, it's something to think about. Makes a lot of sense. Anyway, enjoy this last movie, curveball. Hopefully you wake up to the lies of men. I had misspoke in movie part four, movie number four there. They Lie, We Live. in that when I'm going over the solar eclipse from 2017, I'd mentioned that the sun was here the day before, now it's here. No. Remember, the solar eclipse is supposedly the moon blocking the sun. The curveballer that finally I tried to wake up to the earth being flat and using the eclipses as the reason for it, will not acknowledge the earth is flat, but has come around to at least admit that the solar eclipse is probably a dark orb and not the moon. And I believe that's probably based on the fact that I showed there a house in the east of me the day of the eclipse, the sun rising to the right of the chimney on that house, and the day before the crescent moon rising about, I don't know, 60 feet to the north. On the north side of the chimney in the east. Well, same thing is here the day before the total eclipse. The moon crescent was in this fork in this branch of the tree, and that's why I'm circling it here. I've got pictures of it on the computer. I don't know if I put any of that in seeing the curve. Series that I did initially on the eclipse, but the sun is way down here in a fork of a tree that's out of this picture on the home page of my YouTube channel. So there's that curveball, but hopefully this last part will wake you up, especially when I get in there to Mi'kmaq. Made a movie, a great documentary on Copernicus and the lie. I remember we were all told that the church was against these so-called scientists and wanted to block them up to keep them from spreading the globe earth lie, when in reality it was the hidden hand, the Jesuit order, Copernicus and all these clowns, the ones that portray the Big Bang theory. That guy, that astronomer, was a Jesuit priest. There's a famous picture with him and Einstein. So the Jesuits have been the purveyors of the ball earth since the 1500s. And you'll see Martin Luther, this guy, I put in his documentary in this last movie part to hopefully open your eyes to the lies of the church, wanting to act like they were persecuting these flat earthers when that's what they wanted us to believe, like they were holding up to the flat earth belief of the Bible against all these ball earth so-called scientists and locking them up. But really, behind the scenes, they were the ones pushing them to publish this garbage, these lies.
According to Google and the mainstream news media, the flat earthers believe that the earth is a flat disk flying through space in an upward direction. And it's not hard to see if you just type in flat earth on Google that this image is literally everywhere. It's not hard to miss, it's very laughable, and you start to wonder why. Could people believe something that our really dumb ancestors believed in, like the thought of ships going over the edge? Because after all, Christopher Columbus didn't fall off the edge. So why is it that people still believe in this ridiculous flat disk theory of Earth? And you wouldn't be crazy for thinking that, because we have many proofs of the globe. We've seen tons of pictures, and none of them show us a picture of a flat disk of any kind. So we understand the frustration, where you're coming from, but let's listen to what one of the most famous flat earthers, Rob Skiba, has to say about this, because I looked at an article about the most recent flat earth convention in Canada, and it said right here, as you can see, that Flat earthers believe the earth is a disc despite overwhelming scientific and photographic evidence that the earth is spherical. So let's listen to what he has to say.
Debunking Flat Earth 101. A few tips to help you, okay? Number one, never forget we used to be you. There's nothing you're going to say to us that we didn't already know and believe ourselves 3 years ago or less. We went through the same indoctrination you went through. We had the globe in the classroom since kindergarten. We had the same textbooks. We've watched the same movies, documentaries, TV shows, been to the same museums. And we all started out saying the same thing. This is stupid. This is crazy. This is ridiculous. Why are we even talking about this? This is the 21st century, for crying out loud. Okay, we used to be you. Number two. None of us belongs to the Flat Earth Society. Okay, so if the first thing you're of the mindset, let's go to flatearthsociety.org or net.com or whatever it is, don't do that. Most of us, I can't speak for everybody, but I think most of us recognize that site as either controlled opposition or just a hoax or just, you know, a joke. None of us belong to the Flat Earth Society, so don't go running there for your information, which leads to the next one. No one believes the upward floating disk theory of gravity. And if you don't know what that is, I made a little animation for you.
Thank you, Rob, for admitting what we all knew, and that's that our Earth is not a flat disk flying through space. Takes a big weight off of our shoulders to finally have someone say that in a public environment so that we can move forward and explain a little better what it is that we truly believe. Because I get asked all the time if I'm one of them flat earth people when I start talking about my beliefs. And I tell them, no, I do not believe Earth is flat. And it freaks them out when I tell them Earth is stationary and it's not flat. Because Earth is just dry land, and it has been since creation. And if you look at an elevation map, it shows you the true elevations of our Earth. And the water is always perfectly flat, with the land having elevation changes, none of which match 8 inches per mile squared. And that's something that blows the minds of a lot of people, because they're like, wait, you call yourself a flat earther? Well, yeah, we've kind of accepted that title, but we don't really believe Earth is flat. We know that only water is flat, so to call it flat Earth is really kind of counterproductive to our cause, because we know Earth isn't really flat. It has many different level changes, but water has been proven level time and time again. And that's not the only thing that's been proven. We also know that there is a lot of deception, and for some strange reason, very few can see it, but for those who can, those are the ones that are more easily led into this movement, because they can see the deception. It's very obvious to them that the footage we thought we saw that was authentic is not authentic at all. Like the stars and the moon in 1960 looked a lot different than they do now, because these are not the stars and the moon and the Milky Way galaxy. They were faking space back then, and they weren't very good at it. They were decent, and when we were very gullible, we believed these things. Doesn't mean we're dumb, we're just very trustworthy. It's in our nature. That's why we believed in Santa Claus when we were kids. And it's the same type of mentality that has allowed us to see that circular window with some of our Earth in the background from a high elevation as being Earth. And that was some of the first times that the Earth was presented to the public, and we all bought it. And these missions were so built up, it was like the main event. And no one had seen Earth at all from space. And here it is, and it's in the background of the picture on the moon. But then we find out where that picture came from, and we have to discount this as evidence of a spherical Earth, because since this time, no man has been far enough away from the Earth to see the entire Earth. All we have seen is a lot of hoaxes, a lot of fakery, and a lot of computer animations. And if you don't see it, like the string here on this satellite, this movement's just not for you. It doesn't mean we think you're dumb or we don't love you, but if you can't see that, that's a string. This satellite being launched in 1980s with the technology they had at the time. If you can't see this fake stuff, I'm sorry, because the technology is getting better and you will be deceived way more often than we were back then, and lots of technological advances that are making it hard for us, even the people that are awake, to see how on earth they do this stuff, because they're getting really good at it. Their mistakes are getting less and less, and people still love them. I loved them growing up. I'm not saying that everyone that works at NASA is an evil scientist with a plot to deceive the world. Many great scientists work there. It's just that the ones up top who are pulling the strings of these puppets over here, and you can see their strings, and they often get exposed for having wire harnesses. It's not something new. Many of us have seen that. However, you will not find this stuff in the mainstream media. They're not going to have a Fox News segment explaining why astronauts are caught hanging from wires, but they will have a astronaut responds to a flat earth theory and then show you a picture of a flat disc floating through space, and the world will laugh just like the enemy knew they would. That's why this information is allowed to be pushed out, because most of you will laugh. And we are here not trying to reach the people who have already been reached. We are trying everything we can to wake up as many people as we can to the fact that your reality is painted in, just like it was with evolution and all of the hoaxes that we have there. They're doing it with the earth that you live on. The world you live on is not what you think it is. The people that run this world are not who you think they are. This world is ran by some evil people, and it was created by our Father, who loves you, and he has done everything he can to show you this love. But the world has done everything they can to hide the truth, to hide the evidence, to make it look like the Son of the Most High was a hoax, and that there was some agenda to teach people love and forgiveness, and that agenda led this person who was trying to trick the world into loving and forgiving everybody and healing the sick and raising the dead through his Father's power to go to his own death so that he can trick you. Guys, it's time to wake up. It's time to wake up, everybody, and understand that you are loved. Eternity is at stake. So many people are blinded by this false science, this religion, and it's very catchy. And I work with people every day who really, they wear the NASA shirts. And if you notice, there's a lot of people wearing NASA shirts lately. And it's becoming pop culture. It's just a part of our reality. But these people up top are lying. You need to understand that. Earth is not a sphere traveling around a sun. There is a reality that is being hidden from you. And that's all we want you to know. We have proof that water is flat. It has been proven. It's not in the news. You won't find it in the news. Don't look for it there. But we have proof that water does not curve around a sphere. Land is not flat. Earth is not flat. I know that sounds weird. Water is flat. Our dry land has elevations that you can see with your own eyes. It's not hard to do. Just use your eyes that were created to see, and your ears that were created to hear. Miracles are about to start happening, and this world is going to start changing.
you believe it, you are one of the stupidest jerks that ever lived on the face of this earth. And whatever is going to happen that they're going to blame on Osama bin Laden, don't you even believe it. When in hell are all you people going to wake up?
An examination of the building's steel beams and columns could have shown whether explosives had been used to slice them, but virtually all of the steel was removed before it could be properly investigated, then put on ships to Asia to be melted down.
It's important for us to not reveal how we collect information. That's what the enemy wants.
And you have no evidence that the government's behind 9/11, and I frankly think it's an awful thing to allege, considering it's not true and you haven't proved that it is. It's totally implausible. Like, we would report that if that were true.
Because these guys own our government. They print our money, and they own not only the government, but they own you. You are their property. So, in other words, these guys print the money, they run the country, and they own you, and they own everything around it. And so they make the laws. And that's why they can decide who can kill who and who can get away with who and who can get away with whatever, because they make the laws and they decide, all right?
And we'll continue to work together to achieve peace. That's what we want. Freedom and peace.
Look at the Council on Foreign Relations. Many members, in fact, the majority, never serve on the executive committees. They never go through any initiation of any kind. They are, in fact, the power base and are used to gain a consensus of opinion. The majority are not really members, but are made to feel as if they are. In reality, they are being used and are unwilling or unable to understand. They may have been or may be members of the Christian or Jewish religion, but that is only to further their own ends. They are and always have been Luciferian and internationalist. They give allegiance to no particular nation, although they have used, on occasion, nationalism to further their causes. Their only concern is to gain greater economic and political power. The ultimate objective of the leaders of both groups is identical. They are determined to win for themselves undisputed control of the wealth, natural resources, and manpower of the entire planet. They intend to turn the world into their conception of a Luciferian totalitarian socialist state. In the process, they will eliminate all Christians, Jews, and atheists. You have just learned one, but only one, of the great mystery.
The people who are running this country from behind the scenes do not care a thing about Americans or bloodshed anywhere.
I think we're going to awaken one day to find out that we've all been too relaxed and entertained and watching television and being entertained with all the cares of life, never realizing what is going on in this country.
In the secret, ladies and gentlemen, they are at least, very bare minimum, 50 to 100 years ahead, beyond what you can even imagine.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back. I wanted to touch base on something that I just found when looking and re-examining the footage from a video I released called The Firmament Caught on Video. And I believe this is one of the first times that we've actually seen the firmament on video. And I've always had this desire to see it now that I know it's there. And we all do. And I was showing these videos or looking through this video, and I noticed that when you slow it down, you go to settings and speed and you put it on its lowest speed, which is 0.25. You hit play at around 108 and you will see a wave move across the firmament before this lightning sprite shoots down from it. So slowing it down, I want you to watch above where it says firmament. There's going to be a wave that goes by, almost like you're looking at the ocean. So watch this right here. You see it? The wave goes by, and then bam, this sprite shoots out of the firmament. I don't know about you, but it looks like it's shooting down out of something. Okay, because everything up here is stationary as it's coming out, as if you're shooting something out of the water, okay, or shooting bullets into the water and looking at them when you're underwater. It looks kind of like that. So I'm going to rewind it again if you missed it. Watch across the screen. Here it goes, right here. Boom. Looks like it's coming out of something to me. Okay. Really cool. You can rewind it and play it yourself many times. I thought that was fascinating, and I'm tempted to go through and look at other footage of these things and see that again, because there's lots of the footage in here, and you can watch it where you see these sprites coming out of the firmament, lighting it up. Beautiful. Okay. Wanted to share that with you, but I also wanted to share some really good pictures of lightning sprites that I forgot to include in the other video because I got excited and wanted to show y'all what I found really fast and forgot to put the pictures. So I had them in a presentation that I linked in the description, but some of you may not have seen them. So here is one of the best pictures I have seen of one of these things coming from the stars. Because the Book of Enoch, again, it says, and other things I saw concerning lightning, how some of the stars rise up and become lightning, but cannot lose their form. So they remain where they're at. And when I heard that, I thought it sounded crazy until I had a memory or a flashback from me watching a video on TV about sprites. And I didn't think much of them because the earth and the way things work didn't really fascinate me at that time as much as they do now. I just kind of believed everything I was told, and now I'm just blown away by the simplest of things, the sun moving across the sky, stars at night, like many of you. But here is one of the first color photos of a sprite. This was back in 94. Not sure if this is the first official color photo we actually have of sprites, but that's what this picture says, so I'm going to believe it for now. Here are some diagrams. I've got lots of diagrams here that you can see that people have made, scientists, not flat earthers, about these things called sprites. Okay. More diagrams. They're all about the same. They all have them appearing around or occurring around 100 kilometers around the ionosphere. Here's some good pictures, which the clouds are only at like 10 kilometers. And again, if you look at these, you'll see in some of them the stars lighting up right up here at top. They'll change their brightness. They'll be really bright, some of these stars. And here are tons of them coming down. And they don't always look the same. That's what's fascinating about them. They have different intensities, different sizes. Usually they're sort of red coming down, but just some beautiful pictures of these things. And the bottom part always kind of looks like tree roots, sort of how lightning kind of has that tree root shape to it sometimes. Here's a good one. It almost, I wonder if that's the firmament behind it. That would be cool. But again, rarely seen by us because they're so fast. Taking a picture of them would be challenging. Here's one that I wanted to compare to it's a diagram compared to the atomic bomb. Kind of looks the same. I wonder if it has anything to do with the firmament. Not sure. We did try to blow up the firmament at one point with Operation Fishbowl. Didn't work. And then here's some more. Beautiful sprites. These things touching the clouds. Again, it's hard to see. This is a city down here, a mountain, clouds just above the mountain, and then the sprites way up high. And again, way up there. Now this one's just beautiful. I don't know what kind of, looks like they're using a security camera to catch this one, but beautiful. Looks like a giant jellyfish or something. I don't know. Really cool. Falling down, looks like fireworks on their way down. This is probably my second favorite picture because they did a really good job capturing these things. The color, I'm sure they probably adjusted the color a little bit, but beautiful picture. And here's a snapshot I took from the video and compared it to a little animated GIF we have over here of a bullet shooting into the water. So you can see that's kind of what they remind me of. I couldn't find a good animated GIF of bullets going through water. That's the best I could find. Sorry about that. But that's what I think it looks like anyways, like it's shooting out of some sort of fluid barrier, which may be the waters below the firmament, as mentioned in the Bible, that we're finding out is actually true, people. Newsflash. It's true. Here you go. Here's some more beautiful pictures of sprites. This one's kind of cool. It's like they're peeking through the cloud here, the little layer of fog. And at the end of the slideshow, I have left you, or the presentation, the video that has all the firmaments compiled, or firmaments, the sprites compiled. So you can watch that there. And I just wanted to share that with you, the newest discovery from actually watching some of the video that I'd released before. And some extra pictures that you may not have seen of them. So pretty cool. Pass this information along. People will think you're crazy. That's okay. Don't worry about it. Love them anyways, no matter what they call you, no matter how many times you get called retard or dumb flat earther or flat tard. Don't retaliate. Don't call them the people who are still asleep. Don't call them globe tards or anything like that. And many people, including Christians, can still believe in the globe and still get to. We'll be right back.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back. Before I get into the funny fake news about the Space Force, where Donald Trump is pretty much putting out a plan that we were warned about years and years ago by a man named Wernher von Braun, I wanted to touch base on that warning before you see this video, because it will make a lot more sense to you and maybe not be as funny when you realize this plan has been known about for quite a while, and all of the fake news and everything pushes this stuff out there right in our faces, and the people who aren't aware of the deception are just kind of eating it up like, oh yeah, this is cool, it's going to be like Star Wars with wars in space, when really it's just going to be something to control us with fear. But here is the Illuminati play cards that I put at the very beginning of this video, and they show a lot of things that have already came true in these cards. If you've never seen these cards, they're sort of like the conspiracy theorist go-to in terms of the corruption, because these were made in 1995, and they have things like 9/11, the Twin Towers, and the Pentagon, and the Boston Marathon, and the Vegas shooting. All these things built into them as if it's part of a legitimate plan by the evil ones that kind of rule this world in secret. So there's some really cool stuff there. Kind of gets really deep. But the rocket scientist, Wernher von Braun, that gave us this warning was a Nazi scientist, and you've probably heard of him, especially if you're a flat earther or a truther. Definitely heard of this guy. But during Operation Paperclip, he came here from Nazi Germany, and he invented the V2 bomber. Really smart guy, really good at what he did, and knew really well the game that was being played. And in his dying days, it said that he became a Christian and was warning people about this deception that's coming up. And I want you to hear what someone who worked with him had to say, and it's really kind of crazy, so listen up.
When I was a corporate manager of Fairchild Industries in 1974 through 77, I met the late Dr. Wernher von Braun in early 74. At that time, von Braun was dying of cancer, but he assured me that he would live a few more years in order to tell me about the game that was being played, that game being the effort to weaponize space, to control the Earth from space and space itself.
So we all know that space is fake, but he is telling us they're going to try and weaponize space to control Earth from space, pretty much, okay? But there has to be a threat. So listen to the threats. This is pretty cool.
Von Braun's purpose in life during the last years of his life, his dying years, was to educate the public and decision makers about why space-based weapons are dumb, dangerous, destabilizing, too costly, unnecessary, unworkable, undesirable idea. The strategy that Wernher von Braun taught me was that first the Russians are going to be considered to be the enemy. In fact, when I met him in 74, they were the enemy, the identified enemy. We were told that they had killer satellites. We were told that they were coming to get us and control us, the dirty commies, that whole story. First, the Russians were the enemy against whom we're going to build space-based weapons. Then terrorists would be identified, and that was soon to follow. We heard a lot about terrorism. Then we were going to identify third world country crazies. We now call them nations of concern. But he said that would be the third enemy against whom we would be needing to build space-based weapons. And the next enemy was asteroids. Now at this point, he kind of chuckled the first time he said it. Asteroids, against asteroids, we're going to build space-based weapons. So it was funny then. And the funniest one of all was against what he called aliens, extraterrestrials. That would be the final card. And over and over and over, during the 4 years that I knew him and was giving his speeches for him, he would bring up that last card. And remember, Carol, the last card is the alien card. We're going to have to build space-based weapons against aliens. And all of it, he said, is a lie. He didn't mention a timeline, but he said that it was going to be speeding up faster than anybody could possibly imagine.
Okay, that's enough of that. You can watch that video if you want to. It goes into how they're faking the meteor stuff, that sort of threat there. Really easy to do, especially with their budget. But really crazy that this was something we were warned about, and you're going to see why it's crazy when you watch this next video, because this is current, and this stuff was known about a long time ago. Okay, so watch this quick video and see what you think.
The Space Force. Does that make sense? The Space Force. We may even have a Space Force.
President Trump has mentioned the Space Force a couple of times, and what he's alluding to is an ongoing debate in Congress that is creating a separate military service that focuses on space and military space capabilities.
Space is a warfighting domain.
Space is a warfighting domain.
Just like the land, air, and sea.
The U.S. has become increasingly reliant on space capabilities for military operations across the full spectrum of conflict, from fighting terrorists in Iraq and Syria and Afghanistan.
We need to protect the American people, and security is going to be a very big factor with respect to space.
In 2001, there was a special commission created by Congress. They call it the Space Commission. And the final report of that commission recommended eventually transitioning to an independent military service for space. Warfighting in space is not like Star Wars. And it, you know, it's not Space Marines. It's nothing like that. There are no military, you know, service members in space fighting in these. It's all remote. All of these are unmanned satellites that the military uses. It's always been unmanned in space. All of our manned space programs have been civil space programs. They've been through NASA.
We have the Air Force. We'll have the Space Force. We have the Air Force. We'll have the Space Force. We have the Army, the Navy.
There are a lot of things that President Trump has said that other presidents haven't said before, but the U.S. military is critically dependent on its space capabilities, and it's something we have to take seriously.
At some point in the future, we're going to look back and say, how did we do it without space?
It would take several years, even if the decision was made today. First of all, for Congress to decide what to do, but then also to implement it once Congress has made the decision. I think it will take at least 5 years, maybe more like 10 years, to transition to a new military service for space.
Because we're getting very big in space.
Now, as funny as that video was, and you guys know that it's fake or whatever, it was out, it was on the BBC news segment last night that I watched, and when I came to the computer this morning at work to kind of pull that up and see it, because I don't have cable, I'm cheap, and I can't rewind stuff like most of you can, so I actually pulled this up on the website just to check it out myself, see if I missed anything, and of course you look up here in the top and you see, why do people still think the Earth is flat? And man flies rocket to prove Earth is flat. And then the oddities sent to space and all of these different things. NASA expert shows us how Earth breathes. And you have all of these different things. NASA's mission to the sun. Like, what is this, a space website? I thought this was BBC News. Okay. But they are ramping up the fake space news like I have never seen in my lifetime. And we have to believe it's real. Look, they even have Elon Musk. And there's a connection between Wernher von Braun, the guy that we just saw, and Elon. And he wrote it in a book. And that's part of the plan. I'm sure that he was aware of that plan. Everybody knows that. But he had the Mars colonization linked with Elon in his book. Okay? That's a little deep. That's a little bit too deep of a rabbit hole for most people, and sounds too crazy to be true, but I'm sure somehow that's tied in, okay, and not just a coincidence like I would hope that it would be. So that was pretty crazy. But you another video popped up after I watched that video. I went to the next video, and of course at the top you start seeing other things. It changes up here. You have want to travel to Mars with Buzz Aldrin on a mission to Mars in Hawaii. They're training to go to Mars, and it's really sad. These people really believe that they can go there, and it's heartbreaking to think that they're dedicating their better years to that, but at least they're having fun. And there's Mark Sargent doing his thing, making the Earth look like it's a disc. I cannot stand when people make the Earth look like a disc and say that it's a disc or call it a disc. That drives me crazy. It's not a disc, people. It's not a disc floating in space. But what it's like to spend a year in space in front of a blue screen. Okay. Well, I know it's not fun watching the news when you're awake and you understand how fake it is. But I just wanted to share this with you and show you that the predictions that were made many, many years ago, trying to warn people that they are going to do space-based weapons, they are now creating the Space Force, and it is going to be huge, people. So I know a lot of you probably love Donald Trump, and I'm not saying anything bad about him, but he used to call out fake news, and it's sad that he is now a part of the fake news organizations. But hey, once you become president, it's not like you can really do anything. You kind of just become a puppet. He would get assassinated if he really tried to expose secret societies and the fake NASA program and all of that, you know. So, and I say fake NASA program. Not everyone that works there is fake. I understand there are some real scientists there, and like 98% of them really do believe that what they're doing is sending people to space, and the things that they're making are going to space. And that's sad, because people dedicate most of their adult life that work at this place, you know, to building stuff like that and contributing. And they don't realize what goes on higher up. And we didn't for many years. I'm glad we're finally figuring this stuff out together and exposing these people for the lies. But not going to make this video much longer. I just wanted to point that out, show you how interesting it was when you actually can start connecting the dots a little bit. But I appreciate you guys for tuning in. Really hope you're doing good. We miss you. Hopefully we'll see you around really soon. God bless.
Time has come to establish the United States Space Force. The space environment has fundamentally changed in the last generation. What was once peaceful and uncontested is now crowded and adversarial. Today's report calls for the creation of a new unified combatant command for space, the United States Space Command. This new command structure for the physical domain of space, led by a 4-star flag officer, will establish unified command and control for our Space Force operations, ensure integration across the military, and develop the space warfighting doctrine, tactics, techniques, and procedures of the future. The second step this report calls for is the creation of an elite group of joint warfighters specializing in the domain of space, who will form the backbone of the nation's newest armed service. Third, this report calls for the creation of a new joint organization, the Space Development Agency, that will ensure the men and women of the Space Force have the cutting-edge warfighting capabilities that they need and deserve. Time has come to establish the United States Space Force.
Hello everyone. I wanted to share something really crazy that I found in the Book of Enoch. It is a set of prophecies that I believe predict the fake heliocentric model that we've all bought into for so long. It's crazy. I know I could be wrong about this, but I came across this last night and I wanted to share it with you guys. And it's in chapter 80. Okay, it took me a while to get that far.
And as you'll see, what I'm about to tell you will blow your mind. And now, it's to give you a little bit of context, it's talking about he had just gotten finished explaining how the stars, the moon, and the sun, how they work, and what the angels revealed to him about their paths. Okay? And after that, there is a prophecy here about what's going to happen with these stars and everything. And it says here, chapter 80, verse 6, "And many chiefs of the stars shall transgress the order prescribed, and they shall alter their orbits and tasks." I think this might be talking about the planets that we look at, the stars that we look at as planets. I could be wrong. Please let me know if I am. It says, "And not appear at the seasons prescribed to them, and the whole order of the stars shall be concealed from the sinners, and the thoughts of those on earth shall err concerning them." Meaning, we don't understand the stars. We think they're light years away. We do not understand them at all. We just believe what we are told. We believe men. We don't believe what the Bible tells us. And we were pretty much blind to it, okay? Because we had a lot of trust in science. And so this heliocentric lie, this heliocentric model was brought about because we did not understand how the constellations work, how close the stars are, that they're in the firmament like the Bible says. And then it goes on to say, "And they shall be altered from their ways, yea, they shall err and take them to be gods." Think about that. Planets are named after gods. So we're taking these stars that are off their paths that we do not understand because we aren't looking at them through the way God wants us to see them, but man. So we name them after gods, and where everybody's okay with that. And it says, "And evil shall be multiplied upon them." I find this very interesting, okay? I'm not going to go much more into detail on this. I just thought that this was a pretty cool prophecy. There are some really cool prophecies about Jesus in here. And again, this was written before the Son of God came to earth. So you can look into those as well. They're earlier on, I think around the 40s and 50s. Really phenomenal prophecies about Jesus. Some that are so detailed, it's just like spot on. Calls him the Messiah, the Son of Man, the Elect One. And does some really good, cool things concerning the Son of the Most High God. So if you want to look into that, look into that. I think the Book of Enoch is really intriguing. I'm going to keep looking into it, as I encourage you to keep an open mind. Don't accept it as true unless the Holy Spirit confirms it to be true inside you. So please be careful with what you're looking into. I really don't know the validity of this book, but a lot of this stuff is ringing true to me so far. Okay? Well, thanks so much for looking into everything you're looking into, keeping an open mind, not blindly believing everything we're told anymore. Okay? Always look into things. I think the world's starting to do a better job of that. Okay? So thanks for tuning in, and God bless.
So, if the stars are not balls of burning gas millions of light years away, but rather angelic luminations, and these angels can fall, and there are those who have fallen, those who have wandered and transgressed, what I find myself wondering at this point is this. How can we even trust the lights we see with our eyes through our telescopes if they are being projected from such fallen, wandering, angelic luminaries? In the book of Jude, the author is delivering a harsh warning against, quote, the ungodly people who pervert the grace of God into a license for immorality and deny Jesus Christ, our only sovereign and Lord. In this short book, Jude uses a variety of very colorful and interesting poetic language to describe these false teachers. Verse 11 says, "Woe to them! They have taken the way of Cain. They have rushed for profit into Balaam's error. They have been destroyed in Korah's rebellion. These people are blemishes at your love feasts, eating with you without the slightest qualm, shepherds who feed only themselves. They are clouds without rain, blown along by the wind, autumn trees without fruit and uprooted twice dead. They are wild waves of the sea foaming up their shame, wandering stars for whom blackest darkness has been reserved forever." It is the following verse where Jude quotes the book of Enoch, saying, "Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about them. See, the Lord is coming with thousands upon thousands of his holy ones to judge everyone, and to convict all of them of all the ungodly acts they have committed in their ungodliness, and of all the defiant words ungodly sinners have spoken against him." And this is very telling, I would argue, that this mention of the wandering stars and their judgment is mentioned in such close context to the mention of the book of Enoch itself. And yes, Jude is speaking about human false teachers, godless people who are leading other people astray by corrupting the gospel of grace itself. And yes, the mention of the wandering stars is being applied in a metaphorical sense to make his point. However, the metaphor really only makes sense in the first place when we recognize it in this theme of deception, of opposition to God, and of judgment. In other words, why would you compare a blasphemous false teacher who is leading people away from God to a wandering star, or a planet as they're now regarded, if those wandering stars, those planets, are simply normal, natural functions of God's created order? No, the metaphorical usage of this term in Jude, in the context in which it is applied, only makes sense if indeed the wandering stars are in fact what we see described in more detail in the book of Enoch. In Enoch chapter 80, it says, "And many chiefs of the stars shall transgress the order prescribed, and these shall alter their orbits and tasks, and not appear at the seasons prescribed to them. And the whole order of the stars shall be concealed from the sinners, and the thoughts of those on the earth shall err concerning them. And they shall be altered from all their ways. Yea, they shall err and take them to be gods, and evil shall be multiplied upon them, and punishment shall come upon them so as to destroy all." Earlier in Enoch in chapter 21, it says, "And there I saw seven stars of the heaven bound together in it, like great mountains and burning with fire. Then I said, For what sin are they bound, and on what account have they been cast in hither? Then said Uriel, one of the holy angels who was with me and was chief over them, and said, Enoch, why dost thou ask? Why art thou eager for the truth? These are the number of the stars of heaven which have transgressed the commandment of the Lord and are bound here 10,000 years. The time entailed by their sins are consummated." And then 2 Corinthians also speaks about the issue of false teachers, and it has this to say. "For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light." And so, while I do realize that probably even a majority of people who are looking into the flat earth might find it ridiculous to suggest that the spherical appearance of the planets could be a deception from the fallen angels themselves, I still have to admit that from a biblical point of view, and absolutely from the perspective of the Enochian cosmology, this idea seems quite plausible. And another thing I find interesting at this point is to note the parallels that would seem to be in place with the concept that I've talked about in the past in regards to evolution, and how evolution itself is first and foremost a spiritual teaching, a doctrine of demons which stretches far back into the ancient occult past. and the modern Darwinian and cosmic evolutionary theories parading themselves as science can be regarded as more or less temporary repackagings of these ancient Gnostic philosophies. And so if we remind ourselves that all of these layers of deception, the layers of false origins and false cosmology, the layers of false spirituality and mysticism, the layers of modern deception such as the controlled mainstream media and the education system and the governments, etc., all these pieces are being controlled by the father of lies, Satan himself, then is it really crazy to entertain the idea that at least as far back as the day when Galileo first assembled a telescope and pointed it at the night sky, these wandering stars, these rebellious luminaries, or these fallen angels, could have been participating in a calculated effort to introduce and promote this new materialistic, atheistic, heliocentric model of the heavens? We are seeing more and more what the luminaries really look like now, radiant and fiery, and appearing almost alive, like rainbow fire from within a crystalline setting, each one differing from one another in their patterns, colors, frequencies. But if we really think about that particular line in Enoch where it says, "And many chiefs of the stars shall transgress the order prescribed, and these shall alter their orbits and tasks." The question of altering their orbits is a fairly straightforward one, but altering their tasks? What do you think that might mean? Is it possible that these heavenly bodies, which appear circular and static when viewed through the looking glass, through the telescope, are simply the projections of light designed to convince the observer of this lying cosmology? Does the Bible not speak of the enemy using lying signs and wonders? Doesn't the scripture tell us that God himself allows this great deception to unfold, capable of even deceiving the very elect if that were possible? You see, many discerning Christians today have no problem of basically entertaining this very real and disturbing possibility when it comes to things like UFOs or the Norway spiral or the apparitions of Fatima. On so many other examples. We actually have no difficulty in accepting the possibility that Satan and his demons can quite easily appear to human observers as flying craft or glowing orbs or ghosts or ascended masters or aliens or whatever else. We can easily imagine the great deception involving any number of these much more anomalous examples. But the planets, we don't even think to question that. We regard them as being obvious and undeniable facets of God's original intended design. They are assumed to be part of the created order. Even though the Bible itself never mentions the planets, only the sun, moon, and stars, and the book of Jude and the book of Enoch make it rather clear that wandering stars are in fact fallen angels. Not only this, but conversely, when you survey the expanse of the occult and magical histories, we find an absolute fixation with the planets. The Bible itself mentions constellations of stars, but the various occult systems of astrological zodiacs take them and turn them into a tool of divination, or witchcraft. And this is where the planets start to take center stage. Throughout ancient times, the planets were associated with the pantheons of pagan gods almost ubiquitously, and this really should be a huge red flag to us. And then, if we take an honest, unfiltered look at the arenas and individuals involved in the development of the so-called Copernican Revolution, we see the same dubious fingerprints of occult groups like the Jesuit order all over it, and scientists, quote-unquote, who are fascinated with things like alchemy and the Kabbalah. For some time now, I've been exploring the idea that this entire false heliocentric Copernican system was conceived of and perpetuated by Satan in order to essentially craft a new narrative through which he and his fallen minions could once again present themselves to humanity as our saviors and gods. This is the entire purpose of the whole ancient aliens meme. So, in that light, the notion that these fallen luminaries, these deceivers might in fact deceive the entire human race for hundreds of years into believing that there are other worlds out there, and thus providing a premise from which extraterrestrials could then come from? Honestly, to me at this point, doesn't seem as far-fetched as one might think.
Searchy with another Mi'kmaq special report. For 1,000 years, from roughly 500 AD to 1500 AD, the civilized world was controlled by Rome. But not military Rome, religious Rome. The Roman Empire had mutated from a military power into a religious one, co-opting the beliefs of Christianity and mixing them with ancient Egyptian, Greco, and Babylonian paganism. Christian doctrine that came directly from Jesus Christ and was transcribed in the Bible stated that each individual had the liberty and independence to govern their own salvation by cultivating a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. The new religious Roman Empire insinuated herself in between Christ and the believer and said if you wanted to have your soul saved, you had to rely on the priests, bishops, and cardinals of Rome. This was the worst kind of slavery because it was a slavery of disinformation. Now and again, sincere Bible-believing Christians like the Waldensians of the Alps, the Albigensians, Jerome of Prague, John Wycliffe and his Lollards, Jan Hus of Bohemia, would rebel against this Roman rule and show Christians that Vatican doctrines claiming that you needed Rome to ensure your salvation were contradicted by the Bible. As a result, the papacy strictly forbade Bibles to be placed into the hands of the common person and only allowed Jerome's Latin Vulgate to be handled by clergy. Men like John Wycliffe painstakingly translated the Vulgate into the language of the people. For Wycliffe, it was English. English Bibles were then slowly and carefully copied and handled by Wycliffe's followers, who handed them out to and taught the people. In response, Roman authorities captured Wycliffe's followers, called Lollards, tied their Bibles around their necks, and burned them alive. It's what Christian, so-called Christian Rome did to all of her enemies, including Jerome of Prague and Jan Hus. John Fox's Book of Martyrs, originally titled Acts and Monuments, is completely filled with examples of Catholic authorities torturing and murdering Christians. And when a Lollard was burned with a Bible hanging around his neck, it was a terrible loss, because not only were Christians being burned alive, but hand-copied Bibles were irreplaceable. But in 1517, a new rebel stepped up, an Augustinian monk from Germany named Martin Luther. Luther was furious that Pope Leo X, Giovanni de' Medici, from the powerful Medici family who helped to rule the world then and including through to today, had sent their attack dogs, the Dominicans, to cheat the common people out of their money by claiming they could buy what is called an indulgence, which is basically a receipt of forgiven sin, by paying money to indulgence peddlers like Johann Tetzel, poor Christians believed that they had some of their sins forgiven. Worse, they were told that dead loved ones were in purgatory, and they could give money to these indulgence peddlers, and the Pope would then release their dead loved ones. Luther wrote 95 short paragraphs or theses, and on November 1st of 1517, All Saints Day, posted them to the doors of All Saints Cathedral in Wittenberg. But what was different about Martin Luther's protest and the protests of previous Christians was the movable type printing press of Johannes Gutenberg. The 95 theses were translated and replicated by the Gutenberg press and spread like wildfire. Martin Luther instantly shot to number one on the Vatican hit list. Now remember, he was an Augustinian monk, but that didn't matter. He was waking people up and freeing them from the Roman chains, and for that he needed to be stopped. He was kidnapped by his benefactor, Frederick the Wise of Saxony, and held at Wartburg Castle for several months to protect him from Vatican assassins. During that time, he translated the Bible into vernacular German, and it may have been the most important thing he ever did, starting with the New Testament and then later the Old Testament. But now the Gutenberg Press started printing off large quantities of common language Bibles, and the fires of the Inquisition couldn't keep up. Other brave Christians, like William Tyndale, also a Roman Catholic priest, began translating Bibles into the language of their people. Tyndale was English, like Wycliffe, and he too was eventually executed by Rome for his crime. But now Rome had a problem. There were too many Bibles and Bible translators to be kept in check by burning them all. A new tactic was born, a tactic that English Cardinal Thomas Wolsey called learning against learning. And that tactic was to discredit the Bible in order to force people to return to accepting Rome as the ultimate authority over their body and soul. In this tactic of learning against learning, Rome would literally rewrite reality and weave a false reality matrix that we now all swim in to this day. For thousands of years, mankind understood the earth to be flat and stationary. Only rarely did men like Pythagoras attempt to claim otherwise. And it's interesting to note that many Freemasons consider Pythagoras to be one of the first of their craft. But now rewriting our reality as a tactic to discredit the Bible became a top priority in the face of Martin Luther's 1517 Reformation, Protestant Reformation. The Catholic response would be the Counter-Reformation, and it would be spearheaded by a Spanish Templar knight named Ignatius of Loyola and his followers, whom we call today the Jesuits. Their first opportunity came from the Vatican's mathematician, a Polish priest named Nicholas Copernicus. Copernicus gave birth to the modern heliocentric model of the universe with his work De Revolutionibus Orbium Celestium, on the revolutions of the heavenly spheres. Copernicus knew he was weaving a matrix of lies and wanted to hold publication of De Revolutionibus until after his death. But powerful Roman Catholic clergy like Tiedemann Gies, Bishop of Culm, and the papal secretary himself, Johann Wiedemannstadt, forced him to publish in 1543. The facts that Catholic clergy forced Copernicus to publish, or that Copernicus was the Vatican mathematician, or that he received his doctorate in canon law from Bologna University. Canon law are the precepts by which Rome governs nations. Adam Weishaupt was a doctor in canon law. Or that he was a Roman Catholic priest. These have all been swept under the carpet. But Copernicus never married, and even the Catholic Encyclopedia had to note that in 1537, King Sigismund of Poland put Copernicus's name on the list of four candidates for the vacant episcopal seat of Ermland, which makes it probable that at least in later life he had entered the priesthood. Also swept under the carpet has been the timing of the publication of De Revolutionibus, right on the heels of Martin Luther's Protestant Reformation. And if that's not clear enough for you, how about this? A Vatican agent named Jorg Joachim Redicus, who was originally born Jorg de Porus, had insinuated himself into the Luther Reformation and was in Wittenberg when he left to become a close student of Copernicus. Sources like Wikipedia claim that Rheticus was sent from reformer Philip Melanchthon, a dear friend of Martin Luther, but it is absolutely Roman Catholic disinformation. In the Table Talk of Martin Luther, the great reformer is quoted as having said, "There is talk of a new astrologer who wants to prove that the earth moves and goes round instead of the sky, the sun, the moon, just as if somebody were moving in a carriage or a ship might hold that he was sitting still and at rest while the earth and the trees walked and moved. But that is how things are nowadays. When a man wishes to be clever, he must needs invent something special, and the way he does it, he must needs be the best. The fool wants to turn the whole art of astronomy upside down. However, as Holy Scripture tells us, so did Joshua bid the sun to stand still, and not the earth." In his lectures on the book of Genesis, Luther said, "We Christians must be different from the philosophers in the way we think about the causes of these things. And if some are beyond our comprehension, like those before us concerning the waters above the heavens, we must believe them and admit our lack of knowledge rather than either wickedly deny them or presumptuously interpret them in conformity with our own understanding." The great reformer Jean Calvin, also known as John Calvin, called Copernicus a dreamer who has a spirit of bitterness and contradiction. Reprove everything and prevent the order of nature. "We will see some who are so deranged," Calvin said, "not only in religion, but who in all things reveal their monstrous nature, that they will say that the sun does not move, and that it is the earth which shifts and turns. When we see such minds, we must indeed confess that the devil possesses them, and that God sets them before us as mirrors in order to keep us in his fear. So it is with all who argue out of pure malice, and that happily make a show of their imprudence. When they are told this is hot, they will reply, no, it is plainly cold. When they are shown an object is black, they will say, no, it is white, and vice versa." Just like the man who said that the snow is black, for although it is perceived and known all to be white, yet he clearly wished to contradict the fact. And so it is that they are madmen who try to change the natural order, and even to dazzle eyes and benumb the senses. Do you think Calvin knew how the Freemasons were used by the Jesuits? When they are shown an object is black, they will say it is white?
We're talking about our government here.
No, we're talking about a crime, Bill, pure and simple. Y'all got to start thinking on a different level like the CIA does. Now, we're through the looking glass here, people. White is black, and black is white.
Very quickly, Rome jumped upon this new model of the universe, and Jesuits like Christopher Clavius used Copernicus and his work to fabricate the Gregorian calendar, the calendar we all use. Rightly did the prophet Daniel say in chapter 7, verse 23, that during his vision, a being standing near him said, "The fourth beast shall be a fourth kingdom on the earth, which shall be different from all other kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, trample it, and break it into pieces. The 10 horns are 10 kings who shall rise from this kingdom, and another shall rise after them. He shall be different from the first ones, and shall subdue 3 kings. He shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and intend to change times and laws. And the saints shall be given into his hand for a time." Very quickly did Rome and papal agents like the Jesuits begin to push this new cosmology. She took over astronomy and either pushed out or killed off anyone who contradicted the idea that the earth was a globe spinning in space and revolving around the sun. Even those that met her halfway didn't keep her happy, and she dealt with them as well. Teague Ottensen Brahe, whose nickname was Tycho, accepted the idea that the earth was a globe spinning in space, but still believed that his own observations and data proved that the earth was the center of the solar system and not the sun. This is known as geocentrism. Tycho wanted to follow in the steps of Martin Luther and studied at the University of Wittenberg, but was forced out by the plague. Brahe's life appeared to be frequently in danger, and in 1566 he lost a large portion of his nose in a duel. He was 20 years old at the time. He later died under mysterious circumstances at the very young age of 54. One of those who claimed it was simply an illness, A bladder infection contracted during a banquet in Prague was his understudy Johannes Kepler. Kepler was a German astronomer and supposedly a Lutheran, yet he had an intimate relationship with Jesuits. In 1597, Archduke Franz Ferdinand II of Austria banished all Protestants, good Roman Catholic that he was, and Kepler fled to Hungary. But the Jesuits intervened and convinced Ferdinand to allow him to return. Kepler grew up with a Jesuit uncle under the same roof of their house in Wildestadt. Uncle Sidaldus was a Jesuit astrologer who also kept a wife. Upon the unexpected death of Tycho Brahe, Holy Roman Emperor Rudolf II immediately promoted Kepler to replace him as imperial mathematician, and Kepler very quickly went to work, rewriting all of Brahe's observations to be interpreted as heliocentric and not geocentric. In a paper titled Kepler's Relation to the Jesuits, Dr. Jörg Schuppner at the University of Leipzig noted that it is well known that the Order of the Jesuits was the most important and the most active Catholic order in the field of science during the 17th and 18th centuries. One field of particularly intensive successful study carried out by the Jesuits was astronomy. Many of their names are associated with the important discoveries in the history of astronomy, such as the discovery and mapping of moon craters. It is nearly impossible to list all the names of those who made serious contributions as astronomers or mathematicians. One aspect of the considerable role the Jesuits played in the history of astronomy was their support of Johannes Kepler. Some of them stood in extensive correspondence with Kepler. Now, it was obvious to protesters like Luther and Calvin that something fishy was going on in Rome, and the papacy needed plausible deniability while she rewrote our reality. That propaganda was presented by Italian astronomer and mathematician Galileo Galilei, and it's absolutely fascinating what user-edited Wikipedia says. In the entry for Galileo Galilei under the subtitle Galileo, Kepler, and Theories of Tides, Cardinal Bellarmine had written in 1615 that the Copernican system could not be defended without, quote, a true physical demonstration that the sun does not circle the earth, but the earth circles the sun. Galileo considered his theory of the tides to provide that required proof of the motion of the earth. Now, there's no link on the name Cardinal Bellarmine, which is unusual for Wikipedia. Maybe that's because Cardinal Bellarmine was Robert Bellarmine of the Society of Jesus, one of the most powerful Jesuits of his time, who was canonized a saint in 1930 and named a doctor of the church. What's more, it is ludicrous to imagine that the earth's supposed large mass doesn't pull the moon and crash into it, and instead the magical force of gravity holds it stationary. Even more ridiculous is the idea that the moon affects tides by pulling on the water. Again, the magical, mystical force of gravity is blamed. South African author Thomas Winship wrote in 1899 his book Zetetic Cosmogony, if the moon lifted up the water, it is evident that near the land, the water would be drawn away and low instead of high tide caused. Again, the velocity and path of the moon are uniform, and it follows that if she exerted any influence on the earth, that influence could only be a uniform influence. But the tides are not uniform. And Wishart uses examples from South Africa. At Port Natal, the rise and fall is about 6 feet, while at Beira, about 600 miles up the coast, the rise and fall is 26 feet. This effectually settles the matter that the moon has no influence on the tides. But Protestant reformers were on to Rome. She knew she needed a smokescreen, and she provided it. Suddenly, history was rewritten, and rather than pushing with her own agents, like Copernicus, Kepler, Galileo, and others, to rewrite our cosmology, suddenly, the papacy was a defender of the flat earth. Well, just look what they did to poor Galileo. Supposedly, Galileo was tried for heresy at the hands of that evil flat earther, Jesuit Robert Bellarmine. He bravely stood by his guns and humiliated the church with a heliocentric spinning ball earth. What happened to Galileo Galilei? Well, for the last few years of his life, he was put under house arrest. Have you read anything about the Inquisition? Do you know what the Inquisition did to people when it truly considered them an enemy? Things like rotating their arms backwards until they were pulled out of their sockets? Inventing special instruments that could be jammed into a person's body to rip open their bowels? Putting them in a special sarcophagus filled with spikes that would jam into them to the bone? Did you ever hear of Edgar Allan Poe? Are you familiar with his short story, The Pit and the Pendulum? About a swinging, razor-sharp pendulum that lowered across a victim and would take hours to slowly saw that victim in half. Did you know it was based upon the Inquisition? A little-known secret is that the Jesuits now own astronomy. When their missionaries went across the world, across our flat Earth, the first thing they did was insinuate themselves in royal courts to become the official astronomer of that kingdom. China is a great example. One of the first Jesuits in China was Matteo Ricci. Ricci and his successors like Adam Schall and Ferdinand Verbiest were all the royal court astronomers and eventually fabricated the calendar for the Chinese emperor. Today, the Jesuits even have their own observatories both in Italy and in America. They use their puppets in American government to steal Apache holy ground on Mount Graham in Arizona. Are they reaching out extraterrestrially or interdimensionally? They appear to have answered our question with the latest piece of technology on Mount Graham, the large binocular telescope near-infrared utility with camera and integral field unit for extragalactic research, also known as Lucifer. And it's not surprising given the success the Jesuits have had in rewriting our reality. Now, we're supposed to believe that Rome was against the spinning ball earth heliocentric cosmic accident cosmology of our modern understanding. Yet at every step of the way, Jesuits or Jesuit agents were there to bolster our false reality, hiding whenever possible behind convenient Jews. And for more on that, see our special report, It's the Jews, from Johnny Cerucci and Mi'kmaq. Needing to contrive an origin for our accidental existence that contradicts the Bible, Jesuit-trained Belgian priest Georges Lemaître is the father of the so-called Big Bang Theory, the idea that first there was nothing and then it exploded. He was a close co-worker of just such a Jewish puppet, Albert Einstein. Einstein bolstered the Jesuit cosmology with his convoluted theory of relativity. The problem was that observations of both scientists and laymen weren't matching what so-called astronomers were telling us. And so Einstein fabricated the theory of relativity to claim that your reality was relative to the time-space continuum. It is purposefully almost impossible to understand. You're just supposed to trust science and astronomy. The Jesuits then jumped on with dinosaurs and Charles Darwin to claim the Earth is billions of years old. And wherever Darwin's theory of evolution had holes, Jesuits stepped up to fill the gap. Jesuits like Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, the father of the New Age, after fabricating the ape-like pre-humans that we supposedly came from, even students of evolution became concerned that there was a, quote, missing link between primitive apes and modern humans. A discovery was made in 1912 to bridge that gap. Having been found in Piltdown, East Sussex, England, it was named Piltdown Man. Unfortunately, it was also found to be a hoax. The skull of a small human with the altered mandible and teeth. teeth of an orangutan. Sometime later, paleontologist Stephen Jay Gould uncovered the father of that hoax, a Jesuit priest named Pierre Teilhard de Chardin. There are many such examples in archaeology and paleontology, and yet, no one asks, why would so-called scientists be fabricating evidence? The goal was to discredit the Bible, and it has been resoundingly successful. Without the spinning ball Earth, Darwinian dinosaur cosmic accident, the Bible is a science textbook. With it, critics laugh and question the Bible, and instead look to human authorities to save their souls, such as the Vicar of Christ himself, who is for the first time in Roman Catholic history, a Jesuit priest. This has been Johnny Cerucci for a Mi'kmaq Special Report.